There are a few exceptions, but usually philosophers have not looked into sustainable development very much because the sphere was the weakest one, and therefore environmental philosophy, which is now developing, is an additional new resource. In this video, I'm going to tell you about the three major fields: environmental ethics, environmental metaphysics, environmental aesthetics, before I conclude by discussing the possibility for a real philosophical approach to sustainable development. Now, the best known field is environmental ethics. The central question is, does nature only have an instrumental value for human beings, such as the ecosystemic value, the idea according to which nature only holds value because it provides services to us, or does nature have an intrinsic value in such a way that we have duties towards nature even when nature is not useful to us? Usually speaking, those who defend the intrinsic value of nature are called ecocentrists because they believe that nature is a living system where the ecosystem is at the center of our world. Anthropocentric people are those who think that nature only has value as a tool, as an instrument for today's human beings and the future generations alike. Now, the distinction between ecocentrism and anthropocentrism has implications regarding environmental law and political ecology. Ecocentrists believe that nature has an intrinsic value and therefore they attribute rights to nature. But entities or people must be able to represent and defend those rights within the legal system. As far as political ecology is concerned, the same principle applies. According to ecocentrists, living beings can be defended with their interests within the political system. They can be defended by politicians, by scientists, or even by environmental NGOs. The second field important for environmental philosophy is environmental metaphysics, because here questions are raised such as, what is nature, what are human beings, and what relationships exist between the two? For many philosophers, the mistake we made in our traditional approach was to consider human beings as totally separate from nature. Human beings are free subjects who possess values and are capable of political and ethical behavior, whereas nature is considered as a set of objects passively determined by mechanical laws about which a number of facts can be stated, but that does not have value as such and therefore does not penetrate our political and ethical sphere. But there are other philosophers who believe that we need to rethink what we mean by nature. The phenomenologist, German phenomenologist Martin Heidegger and the French specialist of complex systems Edgar Morin both believe that we have to regenerate the initial Western thought about nature, that of the era before Socrates, where nature was considered as self-production, self-producing. It produced itself. It was a circular sort of production. Edgar Morin provides many examples of self-production or self-construction, such as vortexes, stars, living beings, or even ecosystems. The third major field in environmental philosophy is that of aesthetics, environmental aesthetics. Again, one may distinguish between different approaches. Eco-phenomenologists believe that the relationship we have to nature is based on our experience. It's something sensitive, qualitative, and even poetic. According to them, The first relationship we have with nature can be expressed through works of art, ecological architecture, ecological town planning, or even in movies or books. The techno-scientist dominating approach, which consists in calculating everything, quantity of CO2 released, etc., misses the essential elements. For some people like Aldo Leopold or John Bird's Calicut, we need a new kind of environmental aesthetics characterized by the capacity to accumulate scientific knowledge. The beauty of nature, therefore, should not be limited to the immediate beauty, what we can see, what we're sensitive to, because this beauty should also be fueled by scientific data regarding the integrity, the diversity, or the stability of landscapes. Now, based on this research in environmental philosophy, we can try to develop a real philosophical train of thought. According to the critics, sustainable development is an oxymoron. You cannot both last, sustain, and develop. Human societies develop to the extent of sustainability or durability, or else they last in time, but that means that they cannot develop. Now, this discussion really exemplifies a very old, ancient philosophical debate, the relationship between being and becoming. Can you both be and become? Can you be and last in time while you're submitted to a change process? You become something else. In Plato and in the Christian Middle Ages, being was something that lasted. You didn't change, you were. You didn't develop. And being was what was dominant. And starting in the early 19th century, especially with Marx, Darwin, and Nietzsche, the power struggle was reversed. Becoming, development took precedence over being and lasting in time. And this was exemplified by the strong economic and social development at the time, and also the discovery of the evolution of species through natural selection. Darwin's work. So if this analysis is correct, the durability at the time poses a great challenge. In our time, how can we think that we can be and become, that we can last and change without falling in a contradiction? Thank you for your attention.